In my peak, I was doing about 70 shops a day, distributing over 5,000 loaves of bread a day. I used to have four of these. I used to have a big three-ton truck. I used to have two Hyundai buckies, and I used to employ three drivers, and I used to operate one myself.
He started that business is long time, but he grew up here, and this is his area most.
Well, this is our family property, and this used to be the shop my dad owned and the shop that I took over when my mom retired. People would walk for 2-3 kilometers to my shop because my bread was cheaper than anybody else's. But then I was exposed to the real poverty and the conditions on the ground for ordinary people. I started selling bread as part of my business, and I saw that if you could discount bread, you could actually grow your business, but also you were in a position to help poorer people.
I like him very much, so he's a bread, even and I can say how much I'm paying now. If he sells for me 10 cents more, I will buy by him.
Then he was doing fine with the bread baking and delivering of bread and all that. Had it rolling for him that time.
Whatever I set myself to do, I was able to achieve up until the point where I blew the whistle on these big companies. I was in Graham Ford's office on the 12th of December 2006. I can remember it quite clearly. He said, I've got something to tell you, that the bread price is going up by 35 cents on the 18th of December next week. What was striking was when he said that we have decided, and I asked him who's we, and he wouldn't say we in terms of the other bakeries, but he said, if you go to Dunes and Albany, they're going to charge the same. No. Immediately the alarm bells went off, and you know, it meant that they had got together and decided, because his words were, we've decided.
The price of bread was increased artificially. It's because there were company directors who sat around the table and decided that at around about the same time, they would increase the price of bread around about the same amount.
Where they basically came together through the Milling Council and the Baking Council and said, you will control that piece of the market, you will control that piece of the market, and these will be the prices that we're going to charge.
Mr. de Villiers of the Baking Chamber's response to Maureen Marud of August Action was that if the bakeries were colluding, they were definitely contravening the law, and he wouldn't think they would be that stupid. I was more devastated because of the impact that it would have on my business. 30 cents a loaf for me, out of my turnover, it meant that I was going to be out of business. I went to see a lawyer. Firstly, I organized some distributors. We were about eight together. We laid a formal complaint at the Competition Commission that there's a collusion happening. And what happened after that was the investigation.
Cartels are secretive arrangements and sometimes organizations by their very nature.
So you've got to have some evidence that's going to destabilize a participant within the cartel. They fear that some consequence is going to happen to them, that the commission is going to knock on their door and say, hello, gentlemen, you know, we know you're part of this. Now, how would the commission know that? Well, the commission would only know that because some whistleblowers informed them that they should be investigated.
The role of a whistleblower is to see injustice taking place and exposing that. But in many instances, people that have been whistleblowers have been targeted and have been victims of those with vested interests.
Cartels, monopolies, guerrilla tactic, they occupy the space, milk the consumer and squish anyone who dares to challenge them.
Premier Foods decided not to supply me anymore, or they stopped my supply. And the other bread distributors that became involved in the action backed off, and I was alone. They hit back quite hard, destroying my business, sabotaging my business basically, and accusing me of fraud, accusing me of being involved in criminal conduct. I'm blacklisted, I'm unable to get credit anywhere. We started losing everything, and the sheriff of the court started knocking on the door, and you know, things just started getting difficult, and I was unable to provide for my family the way we were used to.
When this happened with the bread store and everything collapsed, he was devastated.
Yeah, it was a very emotional decision to close the business and to sell it, because it's been in our family for so long. Okay, this used to be my bread slicer. This, of course, was my pride and joy. My oven, which used to feed a couple of thousand mouths a day. I paid 160,000 for this kit, this bakery. It's worth very little now. It's basically worth the scrap metal. It took me quite a while to get to this point, and it took me a lot of hard work to pay for it. And it's all just down the tubes now. Somebody just pulled the rug out under me, and it does hurt. It does hurt quite a lot. It was a difficult decision, but once I was in it, the more they victimized me, the stronger I would resist them. It was either that I would walk away from it or go all the way.
Companies have gotten dramatically richer. The 10 years of the best economic growth this country has seen, and the majority of citizens getting poorer.
Cooking your bread, which is the staple diet of our country, which is still being held, a monopoly still being held by four companies.
You wouldn't expect a gentleman in a pinstripe suit to slip into shacks on the Cape Flats and take a slice of bread out of every unopened sliced loaf, but when the price is artificially inflated, that is the effect of what has happened.
Oh, the price fixed, I wasn't surprised at all. I think there's always the temptation when you have a few big players in a market like the baking market, there's always going to be the temptation that people are going to circumvent the law, and we can just be happy when they get caught out doing it.
Now, these four companies operate, of course, under different brand names. Tiger Brands have their own brand names. Pioneer have their own brand names, Premier have got their own brand names, and Food Corp, they've got their own brand names.
Hello, hi, my name is Tristram. I'd like to know if I can speak to Mr. please. We're doing a documentary on bread. We've sent an email to Mr. A while ago, and we haven't received any reply yet, so that's why we've...
Shame. Okay. So please resend it to me, and then we'll see what we can do.
Okay. And he's not available to comment right now, to speak right now?
Spend a larger proportion of their income on food than what wealthy people do. I mean, in South Africa, The poorest half of the population spends more than half the income on food, and the richest 10% of the people spend maybe 5, 6, 7%.
It's millions and millions of ordinary people who were affected by the bread price fixing. They buy bread day in and day out, and when the price of bread increases, it diminishes the number of slices that are available on the table.
See, staple foods tend to have an inelastic demand in the sense that prices don't really impact on whether people will eat or not. So people will always eat regardless of what the price of food is.
And then you have consumption level strategies. So cutting down on meals, cutting down on certain luxury items. Luxury items include vegetables, tomatoes, they include oil, they include toothpaste, they include a lot of things that some South Africans wouldn't even consider luxury items.
South Africa indeed is able to produce food to can be able to cater for everybody.
The irony is that whereas as a country we've got food security at a national level, but when you look at a household level, there are lots of families who are food insecure. Over 29% of South Africans go to bed without food, and that is alarming.
If more money in the household budget is going towards food, there's less attention on medical care and health care.
The poor households generally respond by cutting back on dietary diversity and increasing the consumption of the staple item.
So there's not enough nutrition on the food that people get. It means that there's an increase in blood pressure and diabetes in communities.
Providing children with adequate food is good for educational performance. Why? Because the physical and mental development of children depend on an adequate diet.
If a child is deprived of nutrition between the age of 0 and 5, you are stunted for life. And at the moment, 3 to 4 million people in this country of that age group actually suffer. In fact, people blame the teachers for poor quality of education. I believe that is actually that lack of access to proper food.
It's very, very difficult because I have to go to my own pockets to save them because fees are not enough. We open at 6 o'clock in the morning and go to the shop and buy bread for the kids for the breakfast and come back and start making the breakfast. It will be a problem if 2 slices of bread can be taken away from here.
Do you have children?
Yes, I've got children.
And
so I'm the only one who's working. Ek is the only broodwinner wat nou brood op die tafel kan sit vir kinders.
Ja, dat ek moet dink hoeveel kinders. Die kinders eet mos baie brood, man. Nou is daar nog kinders wat op die pad wat daar buite dwaal, wat ook 'n stukkie brood soek.
3 years ago, it was 6 rand 50 or 7 rand. It's now going up to 13 rand.
Ja, kinders, is amper 10 rand. Ons betaal, en ons en die menne wat betaal, sê 8 rand tot 8 rand 50 brood nou sê.
En die broodse polis het elke dag op. Is nou amper 8 rand tot 10 rand brood.
I paid 9 rand for the bread of old bread.
Going up, it's going up. The bread price is going up all the time. It's going up.
It's too much expensive, bro. It's too expensive.
Pioneer.
I pay for it, so
I haven't a clue. I just buy bread because we need it. I really haven't a clue what the bread price is. I think it's about 5 or 6 rand. I'm not sure.
A loaf of bread at the moment, that is a good question.
Cost-wise? Gosh, I have no idea.
I think 13 rand, because we buy brown bread.
We don't buy white bread. So
we buy yeah, so 13 rand or something.
Ek sê mos jy ryker, wat ryker. En die armes, wat nog armer. Van die man is gewaarried die.
you live in a society which is very unequal, which has 300 years of racist rule behind it, in which we're trying to develop some form of nation that holds together, and we can't hold together if we're going to have these disparities. And we can't hold together when some people are going to be so bloody-minded that they want to steal off the poor. It's just not on.
We'd really like to speak to someone directly. That's what we're here for, to speak to someone regarding the issue. We'd like a direct statement. So we have tried to get hold of them before, by phone, by email. Now we're trying to come here and speak to them directly.
Okay, let me just
find
out from parents.
Cool, thanks, man. We want to discuss the case of the bread price collusion.
Okay, thank you,
Mr. Thank you. Bye.
In February 2007, Tiger was served by the Competition Commission with a complaint related to collusion around bread pricing with a number of our competitors.
They were found guilty. They came to our court, the Competition Appeal Court, but before we could hear the matter was settled.
And what we actually did was that we continued with our cooperation with authorities, and in November 2007, we agreed to pay a penalty of 97.5 million.
It's a considerable fine, there's no question about it. I mean, probably one of the largest imposed in South African competition history.
Some of them said that they refused to admit that they're guilty, and those cases were referred to the tribunal, and the tribunal basically imposed in 2009 10% on the total turnover of two or three of these companies.
This is me at the tribunal hearing where Tiger Brands was being fined. And this is the CEO of Tiger Brands at the time, Nick Dennis. That's the article that came out, Bread Boss Quits. So the CEO of Tiger Brands took full responsibility for the price fixing by resigning. I actually had a very good discussion with him at the time, and he sort of felt genuine remorse, and I think he did the honourable thing by taking responsibility.
We've introduced an ethics hotline in order to ensure that we create a climate where any one of our employees feels comfortable that they can raise a concern where something is done that is illegal. We encourage our employees to speak up when there are improper practices, illegal practices, unethical practices, because our brand and our reputation in the market is important.
Unfortunately, what we have found was that the fines imposed by the competition authorities do not go far enough to deter this practice. Even though these companies have been levied fines and they paid huge amounts of fines, we haven't seen the price of bread and other commodities coming down.
In the case of the bread pricing, they were fined about 100 million rand, and the next day they increased the price of bread, and so we paid for the fines ourselves.
Profits were made even though huge fines were paid, so the profit was less.
The fines are collected by the competition authorities and are taken to the big sack in the treasury, and they get used for all sorts of things. What we had asked for was that these fines must be used for poverty alleviation program.
It's been an ongoing struggle in this country for poor people to get access to their basic right, which is one of the basic is food.
Yeah, seeing people suffering from buying bread, I volunteer to be one who stands for the consumers.
There is clearly within our constitution a commitment that people should have access to food.
Consumer organisations and distributors are now saying, well, we've been hugely impacted detrimentally as a result of having to pay far higher bread prices than otherwise would be the case. So the question was the launching of a class action in order then to determine whether the class should be paid damages.
We do not anticipate that money will come into our individual pockets. What we want to see at the end of the day is that as consumers, we must be able to get bread at a fair price that is not artificially inflated.
Justice becomes a very expensive business, and sadly so. And in the area of competition law, the area we're talking about, the fees that are charged are outrageous and are way beyond the scope of the ordinary person.
A class action is a cheaper way of getting a civil dispute adjudicated. It will be good for the average South African because a lot of people have had the same problem. They can all take that problem up together with one set of costs instead of individually with a set of costs for each of them.
Class action is going to play a big role. It is still difficult because there is no culture of class action in this country. But I think the future looks much more positive.
The development of class action suits is a wonderful way to keep corporate South Africa honest.
We are at the Supreme Court of Appeal in Bloemfontein to appeal the judgment of Acting Judge Van Sail, in which he dismissed our application to be certified class representatives in order to pursue a class action against the breed cartel.
This is the first class action of its kind ever in South Africa.
The legal principles which have now been created with regard to class actions will of course ensure that class actions will take place when the government doesn't deliver, whether it be education, whether it be housing, other forms of social goods that we're talking about under Section 27 or Section 26 of the Constitution.
The lack of service delivery at government level and the amount of protest that has gone on because of lack of service delivery is the probable reason for no legislation about class actions being on the statute book. The government doesn't want to give the people a stick with which to hit it.
Which is really bullshit, actually. You know, it's really bullshit. You spend your hours listening to people. What is a class? Did they make profit? These are crooks. I don't want to actually record it. The managers of these three companies should be in jail, actually. They basically be found guilty of crookery. The gates of class action must be opened so that we can access justice for the poor, which is the hurdle right now, is the cost of litigation.
This is a contestation between billions of rands against millions of poor people. It's reflected in the court. You have about 20 senior counsels representing a few big companies. And then you have three lawyers
representing millions of people. So there's actually no contest.
I was wondering if you weren't representing one of the bread companies?
We can't talk for them. You must contact them directly.
What was the crux of your argument there?
Well, that there was no case made out in this matter on the paper.
Okay, would you like to be a little bit more?
No.
Explain a bit more
no.
on that?
Go well.
Would it be possible to set up a time to have a discussion at some other point?
You know, you should speak to the bread companies themselves. I don't think you need to speak to us.
Okay, thank you for your time.
We're seeing this as just another step in the process. So should we not be successful here, we still have another shot at the Constitutional Court. That court case is what is the focus right now of my life. I've lost at the High Court, I've lost in the appeal, I'm now at the Supreme Court of Appeal, and I'm prepared to take this case right up to the Constitutional Court.
Landmark ruling that we got from the Bloemfontein Supreme Court.
What came out of the decision of the Supreme Court of Appeal was a procedural framework. We still don't have laws, but the court clearly indicated that we cannot wait for the legislature.
It's been 6 years since the initial complaint, and it's a significant victory.
The second appeal to these companies is a serious appeal. And if they can show that they have the interest of poor people at heart, then they won't be hit that hard when it comes to us winning the case, because we intend to win the case.
Be a very angry person. I used to be very angry with my own self most of the time.
He was forced into something that he didn't like being a shop assistant, which he didn't like. He didn't like to be in four walls all the time.
But it wasn't fulfilling enough with my own self-actualization.
And as a family man, wasn't always the best of the father. He was really, how can I put it, not happy.
My dad was a really strong person. We didn't get along because I had different political and aspirations for myself.
His daddy was really strict with him. I think too strict.
My surname, my dad always told us, you are a Mukaddam, you're different. Because Mukaddam in Turkish and Arabic means leader. He never walked away from a fight. He didn't win all his fights, but he never walked away from a fight.
Do you think this is almost a way of earning his approval?
Maybe to a certain extent. maybe yes.
I could imagine what the father would have said now.
What do you think he would have said?
Go for it, my boy. Go for it. Go all out.
CTV is a local Cape Town-based community television station. It's essentially an NGO. It's a not-for-profit organization. We are progressive, so we promote social justice, democracy and human rights. So our focus will always be on the marginalized. I wouldn't be here if I didn't believe that media is a very powerful tool to bring about social change.
You know, every radio station that used to phone you, house to record them. I've got all the recordings. They call, used to call him the David and Goliath. One presenter called him David and Goliath.
Yeah, one of the most ironic things about working at Cape Town TV is that I'm working right next to Premier Foods. And as you can see outside of the window is the building. And most of the day you get the smell of bread, which I was quite accustomed to when I was in the bread industry. And I'm always getting the smell of bread, so I feel quite comfortable in the environment. So this is the big Premier Foods, and I think we've given them a run for their money.
I can share with you in estimated figures between the activities that we do within the Tiger Brands Foundation and what we do in our corporate CSI, we spend around 40 million as an estimate. But for us, what's important is do the right things because it is good to do good.
Yeah. The question whether they feel remorse, I mean, for us, just looking at how big companies behave in any case, there's absolutely no indication that is so. For them, it's part of business as usual.
I think white-collar crime in this country is not dealt with as well as it should be. You know, every day in these courts, we get files of this kind where people have been sentenced to terms of imprisonment by magistrates in unrepresented cases. They may have stolen two bananas from Pick and Pay, and they get 6 months in jail. And yet people can steal millions, hire fancy lawyers, and the next thing, judges become very sympathetic and say, well, you know, shouldn't be in jail. And I'm troubled by that.
They make sure that the corporate monopoly interest overrides the interests of the poor, and that is why we have 40% of our people living beneath the breadline.
I'm afraid the political will is lacking. There is endemic corruption in high places and a desire to keep that corruption covered up.
We're living in a hypocritical society with a hypocritical government. They speak left and they act right.
This government is trying by all means to help those who cannot be able to help themselves. But I wouldn't need to comment on it as to whether is it enough or not enough.
Government is backing the monopoly horse, I'm afraid. A lot of the central planning is perfectly legal.
You may remember that under the apartheid system, we had all these boards, you know, the banana board and the carrot board, and we had a bread board. We had a, you know, that was the problem. So prices were fixed. And my guess is that what has happened is that you know, it was almost too tempting not to continue.
Anti-competitive behavior in South Africa is really endemic. And this is because of our history. Whether you look at cartels or you look at monopolization in the classic sense of the word, you will find either state-owned enterprises or formerly state-owned enterprises. Government itself condoned and sometimes even sanctioned cartels.
There isn't a well-entrenched culture of corporate ethics in South Africa. What you've got to remember is historically, those active in business in South Africa were prepared to tolerate the crime of apartheid. Where do you get a high ethical standard out of that?
The entire South African economy is built on a colonial foundation of theft. Theft of land, of violence, of forcing people to leave their homes and their families and go to work in the economy.
price of a loaf of bread. The wheat content is only part of that value. There's all sorts of other things, transport, distribution, storage, that have to come into the process. And it goes through, the first process is always milling, and from the milling it'll go into baking, and eventually will end up with the consumer. You have to have competition at each level of this process. When you don't have competition, when you've got concentration, in any of these levels, then you start having problems.
It's a complex food system problem that you have to address, and the Competition Commission is not an effective tool to address that. You've got to rethink the functioning of the food system.
Why do we till the land? The first thing that we till the land is because we want to make a difference in terms of food security. We want to produce food.
Here, we are planting some vegetables because we were not working. We were trying to make even some jobs by doing this, you see, so that we can have something to eat. People, they can start their own food gardens, even if it's in a backyard.
Food sovereignty is a better concept to look at than food security, but it's the idea of a solidarity economy, solidarity community, which is really based on cooperatives that produce food at a local level.
The aim is to see to it that each person is able to have food on the table. Hence our minister, Dina Jumat Patterson, says one household, one garden.
We only eat this bread, which is baked at the community bakery in Belleville. We don't eat commercially produced bread from any of the big bakeries in my home. It tastes really much like the bread that I used to bake.
This revolution is happening. This conscious consumerism, when people start saying, I'm going to buy local and I'm going to be conscious on how I'm buying, that the product that I bought, there was no child labor, there was no exploitation, the workers were paid a fair wage.
Companies need to start to see their consumers as part of their community.
The corporate mindset that no matter what, consumers have no alternative and they will continue to buy no matter what. And this must change.
Many have learned that there's a lot to be lost from your own reputation as a business. The climate within our society says to corporates, clearly this type of conduct will not go unnoticed.
All I read are people who say, no, no, get government out of the way, get regulation out of the way. Well, if you get regulation out of the way, you're going to get cartels. Why? Because the idea that these four competitors would have been ruthlessly competing against each other in order to increase market share doesn't always work. And it doesn't always work if they think they can get away with it. And they will always be able to get away with it when there is inadequate regulation. And that's the problem. This is not a binary debate between some Stalinist society on the one hand and some mad Tea Party arrangement on the other. It's the question of really looking to see how we can ensure that our markets work fairly and freely. And that they can't do so unless blockages are destroyed.
It's not about philosophy. It's about basic needs, righteousness, morality, values. Jesus comes along and says, it's a sin. Karl Marx and his peers come along and say, it's theft. Muhammad says it's haram. So there's always been in all the religions, greed is sin.
Take the bread, it reminds me of Jesus taking on humanity. When I break the bread, it reminds me of Jesus being broken for humanity. So those symbolism help us as Christians to identify with those who are poor, who don't have bread every day.
In Judaism, bread is seen as the most important food.
In fact, we have more rituals around bread than any other food. Bread for so many thousands of years has been the staple diet of humanity, that bread represents to us not just the food that it is, but all food and all life-giving sustenance.
This is essentially what Eid al-Fitr is about. After the month of Ramadan and the fasting, it is that we celebrate, but we can only celebrate fully if we know that those that are less fortunate than ourselves also have something to eat. And that is an important fundamental principle of the Islamic value system. This was a feature in the Eisgenoot magazine, where they actually got me as a hero. It's a form of struggle as well. It's using the newspapers effectively to get your voice heard and a perspective out there. But even Minister Trevor Manuel took note of my work. So yeah, the newspapers does help. Well, in most cases, I just pray to the Lord that it doesn't go to my head. That mustn't change who I am as a person. This article here sort of illustrates what I actually went through. They took a more personal take on the fact that I was being victimized and that my business was suffering. And the media campaign there didn't help much. No amount of media attention can change your own personal situation. When you've got all this glamour and glitz around you with the media, it doesn't mean that your kids are not going hungry at home or that you don't have personal issues and crises.
In Johannesburg at the Constitutional Court in Bloemfontein, hopefully the final leg of this class action certification process.
It is big in the sense that it's a test case. It's the first time that this court has had to grapple with the ideas about certification of a class.
It's just the lawyers that's benefiting. They're like vultures picking the last bits of meat. They're having a field day and they're enjoying every second of it. It's starting to work on my nerves because they're the only people making all the money. If you look at the amount of money that has been spent on legal fees so far, it could have been spent on reducing the bread price. If you look at where this court case is right now, I'm stuck with all this obsolete equipment. I've lost my business, I've lost my bakery, I've lost my bread distribution route. And I'm still stuck with the 700,000 cost order as well.
In the first court in Cape Town, all those years ago, costs awards were made against Imraahn Mukaddam because he was the unsuccessful litigant.
If they do affirm a cost order against me, it will really be a travesty. It will mean that very few Davids will stand up to take on the Goliaths of the world.
He's at risk in relation to those costs awards, and it will ruin him if the costs awards stand.
What is the counterfactual difference? And you say, well,
yeah, it does you know, make you feel that I shouldn't have spoken out. I should have maybe just gone with the flow. I shouldn't have been as vocal as I was, and then also this. You know, this feeling of being of being abused. You know, I feel that I've been abused by the system.
in two separate worlds. You know, this side of the N2 and that side of the N2 in Cape Town. It's two completely different realities. Those who make economic decisions, like the owners of the bread companies, I don't think they see ordinary South Africans as human beings. It's just numbers on a page. It's inhumane.
See now, coming, this kitchen is closed. No food I ever got, popo. Nothing, sorry for that answer. I got nothing, but okay, I see for myself the piece of dry bread. It's all right for me. It's all right.
How do you steal from poor people the last crumbs? How do you justify that? You know, and doing it in such a blatant manner. How does somebody, a director of a company like Tiger Brands or Premier Foods, how do they sleep at night knowing that they're actually contributing to the suffering and the poverty of poor people?
What can we do? What can we do? This is a critical question. The first thing is to getting angry, to get pissed off.
Our only solution is going to be the uprising. So people are not going to wait for government to develop a beautiful constitution or for that trickle down to reach the poor. They're already doing their thing.
Throughout the world, peasants are standing up, landless people are standing up, unemployed people are standing up, and saying that we are no longer going to tolerate it.
Ordinary South Africans must get organized, must get educated, and must stand up.
You need change. You need new people. You need new culture in South African business in general.
Professor Michael Blackman, who is South Africa's finest company lawyer, when I used to teach corporate governance in his company law master's course, and I would always ask for 8 lectures, and he'd say, well, why do you need more than 3 minutes? And I'd say, why is that? And he'd say, because all you've got to say is lock them up.
But what was clear is that the activities were done largely by individuals within the organization. It was actually done without the knowledge of senior management.
We're actually asking for their arrest, by the way. The directors of the three big companies.
And there is now a new legislation that's been promulgated. It's prescribing criminal penalties for cartel conduct. An executive or a director be liable for imprisonment of up to 10 years.
We demand from the president that he finally announce the implementation date of the much delayed Competition Amendment Act 1 of 2009.
You know, society is suffering from this messiah-like syndrome, waiting for someone out there to do things for themselves. Communities have been the ones that have been robbed. Money has been taken out of their pockets. But, you know, they seem to think that government will solve it all for us. And I'm saying, people must be involved because this directly affects them.
Many a time we are looking at government and we say, government, you need to help us. But we need to change that perspective and say to ourselves, what are we going to do to change that?
The research reveals that of every 10 people on Earth, one will never be corrupted, one will always behave corruptly, and the other 8 could go either way, depending on the circumstances.
I've just donated the whole bakery to the Khoisan National Kingdom. It's been standing dormant for the past 3 years, and it just was starting to really bug me that you've got this valuable equipment and nobody's making use of it.
I remember 100 years ago, natives were dispossessed of their land. You are in a position to put food on those natives' table. I thank you for what you are doing.
If you read through the Torah and you see the story there, it's absolutely frightening. Goliath says to him, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to destroy you. And David is somebody who's just not intimidated. He's able to stand up and say, I'm the one who's going to win. I'm going to take you down. I know that I have God on my side. I know that I have right on my side. And he absolutely refused to be intimidated.
Whistleblowers are our heroes. They take immense courage in what they do.
Imraahn is an old struggle stalwart, and he's holding up very well. It's been a long time, but I think this cartel, in effect, has changed his life. From being a bread distributor, he's become an activist.
And if he wanted to, he could have carved himself just a nice niche out with his bread companies and enriched himself around it. But he stood for the right moral questions, and he raised and blew the whistle on many of these bad practices.
I had to go through that crisis to really find who I am and where I want to be, and also to realize that there's more to life than just money, and there's more to life than just this constant struggle for material gain. I'm past the bitter stage. I would like to do some business with them. If they can come and advertise with Cape Town TV, it would be great. But I don't think I'm the right person to approach them. I have to get closure. I have to get closure with this chapter in my life. And this is a fitting way to close it. The legacy that I want to leave behind is one that has changed the course of law in South Africa. If you have a law, Imraahn Mukaddam versus Pioneer Foods, at the Constitutional Court, and that judgment writes how class action is defined for time immemorial, that is important to me.
We want to live a sustainable life. We're going to have to learn to do it on a basis that does not allow greed to get the better of us.
I think to be human is to struggle alongside other human beings for our shared humanity. And if you aren't speaking out, then you are really saying the situation is okay and going along with it.
The more you see, the more you gain, the more you give, the more you get. It is by giving and by sharing and by cooperating and by involving and by creating communal societies, people will realize that the only way to survive is to actually reevaluate the way they live, the way they accumulate individual wealth. And that will bring about the kind of society that we're all dreaming of. And it can still happen in our lifetime if enough people become committed to these ideals.
The fight for economic justice will continue. The struggle will continue. The political movement that is confronting capitalism internationally is bigger than this building, it's bigger than this cause, it's bigger than Imraahn Mukaddam.